Thank you, Professor Debat, and thank you for the invitation of Knight. Long time no see. We hope to meet maybe soon in person. I would like to use a 3R to identify the BRI after the pandemic. The first R is resilient. People talk about globalization. It's not driven by the so-called new liberalism anymore. I'd like to identify this is a Washington consensus based off capital, by capital, and for capital globalization. Of course, simply global financial crisis is our troubles. After the breakout of the pandemic, this is the end, people said. So now people talk about the resilience of the globalization, diversification of global supply chain. And even I use maybe globalization, global regionalization. So it's not just a globalization, that's the in general. So for the BRI also resilient. The one example is the China-Europe Rail Express, 10 years now it's anniversary. At the beginning, many people questioned about the efficiency, the costs. But now, last year, 51% growing. So far, there are more than 40,000 turns from to connect more than 190 cities. So that now this, because of the air prohibited, the sea also low efficiency. So during the pandemic crisis, the BRI increasing the China-Europe Rail Express is one of the good example. At the beginning, of course, the pandemic makes so many challenges. People cannot move freely, and also the goods also cannot move freely. So now we have a so-called green light and a fast track to make sure the engineers and workers and can move freely without necessary so-called 14 days quarantine, start from here and then land. So this caused many troubles. We have some special arrangements with the BRI partners. So that kind of, I think, is resilient for BRI as well. Second R, I think it's reassure the high quality of development, the reiterate, I think the so-called the high quality of BRI development. There's a second BRI forum 3 years ago highlight. The meaning is we just not rely on just the capital invest or labor, cheap labors or resource, full of resources. That kind of consumer of resources, labors, and also money. So this is called not high quality. So-called high quality means we pay a higher attention to the green Silk Road and pay higher attention private companies, private capitals, and also high quality of the infrastructure building. So now it's more focused on the digital infrastructure. I think that's very important. China also, we initiate so-called dual circulation strategy. That means majority of the Chinese economic growth, not from abroad, more and more from the consumer, because we have 400 million middle class in, by 2035, we'll be double, so 800 million middle class by 2035. So consumer will be driving forces for Chinese economic growth, not just the exports, trade, or FDI. And then the BRI also, because of the high quality orientation, so it's not just the cause and errors actively participant from China, like Yangtze River, Pearl River, Delta Economic Zone, or Beijing, Tianjin, and Hebei, that kind of driving forces for China's economic growth. But now even Chongqing, Chengdu, inland cities, some as be the pioneers of the BRI cooperation with with other countries. So we high quality after the pandemic, we are more highlights of the regionalization, like RCEP, even China and the European Union reached a comprehensive investment treaty. So now it's waiting for the approval by the European Parliament, now suspended because of the sanctions, anti-sanctions, political trouble. Sooner or later will be approved, I'm sure. And also China declared to join the CPTPP negotiation. I'm thinking maybe next year, United States will come back of the negotiation with CPTPP. So that's a very high standard of regionalization, particularly in some new areas like e-commerce, digital economy, AI, and all this WTO without arrangement or rules before. So I think the high quality reassurance. Third arm, I think it's a transformation, re-transformation. So-called re-transformation because BRI always transform according to the needs of the other countries, according to the globalization transform. But now we say re-transformation, the meaning is after the pandemic crisis, every country highlights three new areas. First, it's digital, because people cannot contact directly. So digital, like online conference, education, medical, everything. So digital Silk Road. China, we have 1 billion netizens. After the pandemic crisis, Chinese digital technology and platform and economy increase rapidly. So many experience we can share with the BRI partners. Second, of course, is for green recovery. I think the pandemic, the reason is because China, because people and the nature relations should be readjusted. So climate change maybe is one of the reasons for the pandemic of the virus. So green, the Chinese government also declared to reach the carbon neutrality by 2035. And climax 2035, 2060 neutrality of carbon emission. Third is for the health. It's more people oriented, people's health. So the vaccine and the masks, all kinds of this, not just for the trade, but also corporate. Even like 17 plus one, China CEE countries cooperation. Hungary be the Chinese vaccinate be made in Hungary and a distribute to other European countries. Many other like Dubai be a center of not just innovation, but also vaccinate producing, distribution. All of this, I think that's very important. So far, China sells more than 290 billion masks to other countries. Many of them is a donation of foreign assistance because of many poor countries. So Chinese government declared that vaccines should be the public goods. That means it's not a commercial goods. It's not just make money. So it should be accessible to every country. Particularly for the poor people, poor countries. And the second, affordable. So it can be used conditions to match the local conditions. So that thing is very important. So digital Silk Road, green Silk Road and health, Silk Road for health. This, I think also because of the transformation of the globalization. So these three R's, I think will be priorities for the BRI. Now, come back to the chairman's question about the challenges, risks in the coming future. I think also the three major challenges for BRI after a pandemic crisis. Firstly, traditionally, we think about BRI's to reform the globalization, make it more inclusive, make it more mutual benefit, make it more balanced, and make it more open. But now, it's not globalization. People think about a deglobalization. Particularly for the United States, they have a so-called de-channelized global supply chain. Even people worry about a so-called decouple. They want to have a new globalization, which led by the United States, a so-called Quad or transatlantic, everything is just one, some of the arrangements. So the BRI to reform the globalization, now they have the new globalization, how to adapt that kind of a situation, big challenges. In the last week in the G7 UK, they have so-called B3W to build a better world. Of course, we are welcome more countries to participate, even competition, invest more in the real economy, particularly infrastructure. The problem is, people worry about even the United States, the lack of the infrastructure building investment, how can they can invest for other countries? It's not a China's advantage, it's not just one area, comprehensive. I think the most important, China has all of the categories of the industrial sectors according to the United Nations. So industrial powers, today still China produced nearly one third of all the industries values in the world. So that, I think that's the reason China's building made in China is most efficient and cheapest in the world. So, but US definitely, they want hating the BRI and make sure the other countries take side between China and the United States, or so-called the Western BRI or Chinese BRI. So even so-called two systems. One system is BRI system, another is a US-led new global system. So that definitely biggest challenge for BRI. Second, I think the transformation, as I mentioned, we need to teach the Silk Road, Silk Road for Health and the Green Silk Road. However, BRI partners, most of them developing countries, they are quite relatively poor. They need to industrialize. How can then to for green recovery, digital, or everything? This is for advanced economy, maybe it's the transformation goal. So it's a dilemma. But now we stopped all the investment of the traditional carbon intensive factories, for instance, in Bangladesh. So-called factories, Chinese investment stopped because this caused more CO2 emission. But how to build new electricity, low carbon, is a challenge. The new energy maybe is too expensive for the poor countries. So this is, I think, a huge challenge. The third challenge, I think, the BRI facing is the Chinese economy. We say a dual circulation strategy. Chinese economic growth so is not higher as before. Before it's around 10% of the economic growth, right? Now, last year, even the only positive economic growth. This year, maybe 8%, but still, we highlight so the high quality open reform. Chinese economic growth driving forces also changing. So traditional BRI, traditional cooperation mechanism, we also need to readjust for. So the six economic corridors, which is according to the Chinese comparative advantages and the hosting countries' comparative advantage designing. Now we may be more focused on the air and digital mutual connectivity from all kinds, all rounds of the mutual connectivity cooperation. So that's also big challenge for the BRI cooperation. So far, according to the new data, I suggest you can access to edailu.gov.cn. This is official website. Edailu is Chinese pinyin of the Belt Road Initiative, the yidailu.gov.cn. They have the updates data. For instance, President Xi's speech in the APEC BRI Corporation and State Councilor Wang Yi. All these new data they can update. So I'm not repeat that kind of data. It's easy for you to access. And I just mentioned about this and welcome your listen and discussions. Thank you.